enemy. We come against every work of the enemy in the name of Jesus, and we say, your time is up. You have no hold, you have no authority, and you have no power. That these people are the saints of the Most High God. These are the children of God, and you have no authority and you have no power in their lives. And we declare freedom in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. 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 It's good, eh? Jesus is good. So good. Awesome. Thank you, Mario. Bless you. Awesome. Thanks, worship team. You guys are legends, leading us into the presence of God week in and week out. Oh, thanks. Cool. Great. If we could just have the front house lights on, that'd be awesome. Thank you. Great. Felt like we just finished that all a little bit too quickly. Who really feels like there was God's Spirit was moving in your life? And yeah, amen. You know, I love what Ellie shared before. You know that, you know, in Ephesians 5 it says, "Do not be drunk with wine, but be filled with the Holy Spirit." And then Paul says, singing spiritual songs and psalms to one another in reverence to Christ. I think it's amazing that Paul first says that we sing these songs to one another. You know, we come to church thinking that we come to sing to God first, but Paul actually says, no, you're singing over one another first and then to God. There's a horizontal and a vertical thing that goes on when we sing. I think that's incredible, eh? God has set it up so that every time we gather, we get filled with the Spirit. It's up to us whether we're going to engage in that, eh? And receive and sing and declare in the Spirit. Yeah, it's cool. It's God. It's good. Love it. All right. So this morning, I've just got a testimony from Erin. Last week, Erin filled in her Connect cards. You'll see on your seat, if you're new here, you'll see that we have Connect cards on our seats. Every week we fill them out. It's opportunity to hear praise reports, hear about what God's doing in your life. It's opportunity to put down some prayer requests. And every week we have had prayer requests come in, and then the following week we're seeing the praise reports from those prayer requests. So that's really awesome, eh? And this week, last week Erin put down a awesome testimony of healing in her workplace, so she's going to come now and share that. Awesome.
Good morning. Please excuse me for reading, but I don't want to get stage fright and forget what I was going to say. Okay, so a couple of weeks ago, I met a friend of mine for lunch at Starbucks in Wellington, and we used to work together, so we've kept in touch, and she mentioned in our conversations that her shoulder was very painful, and it was keeping her out of sleep, and so I asked her how it was injured, and she said that she was in the garden about 3 weeks before, and she lost her balance, and she put her arm out to stop her fall, which it did, but because her arm was stretched out in the wrong direction, she hurt her rotator cuff. So, yeah, any movement of her arm just was so painful. And she was saying that she'll probably have to go and see someone about it and get surgery to fix it in the end. And so at this time I was thinking I should pray for healing for her, because I'm sitting here with something in me that can fix it instantly. So I thought the gift has to be shared. So my friend doesn't follow Jesus, but I talk to her about him a lot. So she is aware that Jesus heals. So when we were about to leave and go back to work, I said to her, "Can I pray for your shoulder?" And she said, "Oh, yes, please." She said, so she turned her shoulder towards me so I could reach it. And so as I lifted my hand towards her to put my hand on her shoulder, I just felt the power of the Holy Spirit rise up and my hand became hot. And so I prayed, "Shoulder be healed in Jesus' name." And I asked her if she feels anything. And she said, "Yes, it's warm, a soothing warmth." So I said, "Can she check it?" And so she moved her arm around like that. And she said, "Wow, it's much better. Thank you." And I said, "Don't thank me, thank Jesus." And so a few hours later after we met, she emailed me at work and she said that she can still feel the soothing warmth. And she said it was really bothering her today. And that night she slept with no pain. Yeah.
Great. Awesome. Anytime, anywhere, eh? Faith. It's great. Thank you, Erin, for sharing that. It's encouraging to hear what God is doing. God's at work, and he's available to be at work in any of us at any time, eh? It's great. Cool. Well, hun, have you got my phone? I just wanted to share another testimony quickly. We were meant to be praying for Lauren and Maury today. It's their last Sunday that Ellie and I are here, because Ellie and I are going away for 2 weeks on Thursday, and next week is Lauren and Murray's last Sunday with us before they move to Canada. So we were going to pray for them today, but unfortunately Lauren is unwell, so she's not here. But you guys can all pray for them next week. But they just wanted to share a quick testimony. So they put on their card last week that they've been praying for a house, trying to sort out a house in Canada. It hadn't been sorted yet, and they're long away. Anyway, so she said, "After a long time looking and not finding much available that was suitable, we've got the perfect place and the perfect location, although it took a whole week to confirm it, which in the natural, after weeks of looking, could have felt stressful. We were reminded that God had it all in hand and he kept us in perfect peace. Phil's prayer and prophecy at Life Group that he was plucking off the unsuitable ones till he found the perfect one was awesome. We just feel incredibly blessed by it and just want to share and testify that there is so much power in prayer and in resting and trusting in the fact that God goes before us and fights our battles for us." Great, eh? It's good. So next week, make sure that you take time to just say goodbye to them and bless them, because they'll be gone for a couple of years. But I do believe that they're going to be posted back here after this, so that'll be good to see them again. All right. The only other thing before I start is we have a volunteers picnic coming up on the 4th of December. So Ellie and I are going away for 2 weeks. We're going to my dad's 70th, then a wedding, and then we've got a leadership week down there. So we're away in Nelson and Hamner for the next 2 weeks. And yeah, 10 days or so, but we're going to be away for 2 Sundays anyway. So, but the week after we get back, December the 4th, we have our volunteers picnic at Harcourt Park in the afternoon. So if you are a volunteer in some way, shape or form at Awaken, you would have got an email. So far, we've got about 10 people reply to that. So if you could reply and say, "Yes, we're coming," then we can sort out all the food and we're going to have bouncy castles and lots of fun stuff and have fun together. Sound good? Yeah. Cool. Last year we went bowling, which was fun, but this year we're going to do a picnic. Cool. All right. Let me start, eh? So Ephesians 6, we've got a slideshow this morning, but we won't start it just yet. But that's cool. You ready to go? I've done a PowerPoint. I watched Joshua's message from a few weeks ago, and I thought, I've got to do a PowerPoint. Anyway, so Ephesians 6, who's read it this week? Good. A handful of people. I've also read it this week, which is helpful because I'm going to preach on it. So who's enjoyed the series though so far? It's been really good, eh? Really, really great. Ellie has preached some outstanding messages, and I read an article the other day on the, like, a pastor's sort of website, and it said, you know, it was about how do you reconcile, you know, be at peace with the fact that your wife is better than you as a pastor. And so it was really helpful because she was smashing it, eh? And it was great. So, but all through Ephesians, you know, Paul has been building towards something, and it's very easy to read Ephesians in chapters because that's the way that it's presented to us. But it's actually one letter, right the way through, and so it's important that we see that Paul was building to something. And so in chapter one, he says that we are blessed with every spiritual blessing. In chapter two, he says you are alive in Christ and seated in heavenly places. In chapter 3, he prays for us to be filled to the measure of the fullness of God. And in chapter 4, he gives us this call to live a life worthy of the call. And in chapter 5, as Ellie talked about last week, about fighting for our families. And it's all arrived at this point. And the declaration in chapter 6 is this. This means war. This means war. So we've got to understand that as believers, as followers of Jesus, we've been planted in the middle of a spiritual conflict. And we don't often fully understand this conflict that we've been planted in. But we've got to learn to navigate through the spiritual conflict without accusing God or accusing ourselves. See, the day that you trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior is the day that you are planted in a spiritual battle. Like any other battle in spiritual warfare, it's also very important that every Christian, every follower of Jesus, knows how to hold their ground, how to stand firm, how to not waver in the midst of the battle, how to protect themselves and fight the enemy on God's terms, not Satan's. And this is one of my main points this morning that I'm going to be talking about is I think that we often fight the enemy on his terms rather than God's. So my prayer is today that the warrior spirit will rise up within us. Shall we read Ephesians 6, eh? You've got your Bibles, let's turn to Ephesians 6. I'm not going to read all of it because Ellie skipped over into Ephesians 6 a little bit last week, which is good. So coming out of Ephesians 5, of course, Paul finishes off by saying, you know, each one of you must love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. And then he continues into Ephesians 6, talking about children obeying your parents and honoring your father and mother, and all of that stuff that goes along with that. But I just want to throw in a little bit for free, if that's all right. There's two times in the Bible that I can see anyway that it says that our prayers are ineffective. One is when a husband doesn't honor his wife, and the other is when we're not being authentic and vulnerable. There's two times. It says your prayers are ineffective. Husbands, if you're not honoring your wife, I'm not listening. Incredible, eh? Honor your wife. And so Paul's finishing off with this. He's saying, fight for your families. Honor your wives. Children, honor your parents. Parents, love your children. You're not doing that, I'm not listening. Yeah. Crazy, eh? Anyway, just thought I'd throw that bit in for free. Ephesians 6. I want to pick it up in verse 10. And this is a well-known passage, the armor of God. So verse 10, finally. So Paul's finishing off the letter. He's saying, in conclusion, this is my final thought. Be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. Let me pray. God, we just love you, Lord, and we're just so thankful that, Lord, even though we've been planted in this spiritual conflict, you have given us everything for victory. Lord, there is no need to fear. The enemy has been defeated. He is under your feet. And Lord, we just pray that this morning, God, that the warrior spirit would rise up within us, Lord, that courage would come upon us, Lord, that boldness would rise up within us so that we can push back any scheme of the enemy. Lord, we thank you for all that you're doing in us and through us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, so chapter 6, verse 10. If you can bring up maybe my first slide, or the next one. Tapping into the source of strength. So in verse 10 it says, in conclusion, be strong in the Lord. I'm reading from the Amplified now. Draw your strength from him and be empowered through your union with him and in the power of his boundless might. Put on the full armor of God, for his precepts are like the splendid armor of a heavily armed soldier, so that you may be able to successfully stand up against all the schemes and the strategies and the deceits of the devil. Who knows that battles are exhausting? You know, an exhausted soldier, he needs to be able to find a place to be rejuvenated, a place to restore his strength. Otherwise, he becomes weak and he becomes a target for the enemy. See, this verse, this part of the passage here is indicating that the source of our energy is not us. The strength doesn't come from us. The strength only comes from the Lord. So Paul is starting off by saying this, draw your strength from him and be empowered through your union with him. Don't try and do this battle on your own. See, we start to lose. Then this is what I'm talking about when we fight the enemy on his terms. See, Jacqueline talked just before about being seated in heavenly places. We are seated in heavenly places, but the enemy, he wants to fight us on the earth. He wants to fight us outside of that heavenly realm. And so he'll try and bring us down to fight with him on his terms. And when we do that, we then start to fight the battle out of our own strength, out of our own selves, rather than actually the strength that comes from the Lord. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that as we go along. See, when we put our trust and our faith in him, then we actually start to put our trust in his power, not our own. The second one here is identify the enemy. In verse 12, it says, for our struggle is not against flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents. So we've got to identify who our enemy is. And Paul does it here. He says, our struggle is not against flesh and blood. It's not against people. It's not against stuff that's going on in this realm. It's actually against the stuff in the spiritual realm. But against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, put on the complete armor of God. Therefore, put on the complete armor of God. See, in warfare, gathering intelligence is key. Gathering intelligence is really, really important. And if you're part of the military, you would understand this, that intelligence is really important. Where is the enemy? Are they over that hill? Are they, you know, how big are they? What do they look like? What are their weapons? What have they got going on? What have we got to defend against their weapons? Which area are they going to come and hit us from? They come from behind, from the side. Where are they coming from? Intelligence is key. It's used to identify and assess the enemy. See, Paul was often saying, church, don't be ignorant. You cannot be ignorant of the spiritual things. You cannot be ignorant of the enemy's plans, of his schemes, of what he is planning to do, what he's got going on. You cannot be ignorant. You've got to be aware. Intelligence is key. See, this passage clearly identifies the enemy. It's the devil and his cronies. Has anyone heard of the book, The Art of War? The Art of War was written by a Chinese guy, and I think you say it, Sun Tzu. Does that sound about right? Sun Tzu. He said this, if you know your enemies and know yourself, you will not be imperiled in 100 battles. But if you do not know your enemies nor yourself, you will be imperiled in every single battle. See, the way that war happens in the real world and also how war happens in the spiritual world, it's the same thing. The principles apply. So although our battle is spiritual, many of the same principles apply. And if we understand the enemy, sorry, if we misunderstand who the enemy is and if we misunderstand who we are, we end up being drawn into every single battle. And life becomes chaotic. It becomes crazy. See, the enemy wants us to draw us into every small issue, to distract us from the mission, to distract us from the purpose that God has in our lives. He's trying to bring us into every little battle. You know, sometimes it's just not worth the battle. You know, as parents, who knows that you've got to pick your battles, eh? You can't fight every single battle with your children, otherwise life becomes crazy. You've got to pick your battles. It's the same in life. We've got to pick our battles. Every little thing is not worth arguing over. Every little thing is not worth having a debate over. Every little thing is not worth being offended over, I can guarantee you that. Come on, I think that's one of the biggest schemes of the enemy. If he can get you offended, he's got you in the natural every time. You're doing battle in the natural every time. If he can keep you bitter, you're doing battle in the natural. So this is how he does it. In the same book, The Art of War, he said, one mark of a great soldier is that he fights on his own terms or fights not at all. That he fights on his own terms or not at all. See, I believe one of the primary issues is we constantly battle the enemy on his terms rather than ours or God's. See, the devil's battlefield is this world. If he can keep us carnally minded or thinking in the flesh, he wins every time. See, he will battle you in the realm of feelings, in the realm of doubt and fear. See, that's where he is. But we're higher than that, aren't we? We live in, where do we live? In heavenly places. We're seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. I like to think that our bottoms are in heaven, but our feet are on earth. Like we're seated in heaven, but we're still in this earth. We're still in this world, but we're not of this world. The things of this world should not have their effect on us because we are seated in heavenly places. See, and I don't know about you, but I'm pretty sure that I believe that the enemy has no authority in heaven. He has none there. So don't you think that that's where we should do the battle? Where he has no authority? But he constantly wants us to bring us down into the natural world, the natural way of thinking, because that's where he operates. So we need to understand what the enemy is attacking with and know what weapon God has given us to deal with that attack. See, the enemy will attack with lies and deception every time. And who knows that the root of all sin is actually just the belief in a lie. See, every area of sin in our lives, every area that we're battling with, every area that has a hold over us, at its very core is a belief in a lie. And that's why God has given us the belt of truth. we can flick up that slide, that'd be great. The belt of truth. Verse 14, stand firm and hold your ground. Having tightened the wide band of truth, of personal integrity and moral courage around your waist. See, the belt in the armor was the centerpiece of the armor. It's the piece that held everything else together. From it, the sword hung. It was the centerpiece of a soldier's armor. So the truth of God's word, the truth about who we are, who he is, should be the centerpiece of our defense system. And see, the enemy will try and attack us with what may be true, and he'll try and trump truth with what is true. Now, that might be confusing, yeah? See, what's true may be that right now you're struggling in your finances. That may be true in the natural. But the truth is that God is your provider. See, we always have to battle maybe what is true with what is truth. And so the enemy will try and get us with deception and lies by saying, well, this is going on in your life, so maybe God doesn't really love you. Maybe God doesn't really care. But we know that the truth is that God knows every hair on our head. He's known us since before we were born, that he had a plan and a purpose for our life since we were before we were even born. That's the truth. Come on, we've got to battle with the truth. So we put on the belt of truth. And so it's really important that we know what is truth. We've got to know what is truth. That's why God has given us his word. This word, his word declares the truth of who he is, the truth of who we are. He says, put that on yourself. Put it on yourself. Strap it on. You've got to know who I am. The other thing is that's important with that is we've got to be doers of the word. Know what is truth and be doers of the word. All right, the next one is the breastplate of righteousness. And having put on the breastplate of righteousness, in the Amplified version, it also explains it as an upright heart. So the breastplate was made of bronze for the Roman soldiers and covered the body from the neck down to the thighs. And it protected the soldier's heart. So for the believer, this means that we have to guard our heart above all else. Proverbs 4, verse 23, guard your heart above all else because it is the source of life. You know, in one version, it says that above all else, guard your heart because out of it flow the issues of life. Now, I believe that our heart sets the parameters for the way that we're going to live our life. Our heart sets the parameters, so it sets up boundaries for our life. But we've got to guard our heart, because the enemy will try and attack our heart. He'll try and attack us in the realm of feelings, the way we feel about things. And I don't know about you, but if we followed our feelings everywhere, we would be all over the place. If we followed our emotions everywhere, we would be all over the place. But the Bible is saying, guard your heart. Guard your heart. In Matthew 15, verse 11, it says, what goes into someone's mouth may not defile them, but what comes out of their mouth, that is what defiles them. And in verse 18, it says that the things that come out of a person's mouth come from the heart. So Satan will try to attack us in this area all the time. He attacks us, our heart. He attacks our feelings, our emotions, our self-worth, and our trust. He is the accuser and will accuse us of being guilty and unrighteous. He is the accuser, not God. Do you know that the Bible says that the Holy Spirit also convicts us, but he convicts us of what? Our righteousness. The Holy Spirit convicts us of our righteousness. So in other words, the accuser is saying, you're guilty. You're worthless. You're not worth anything. You know, you're full of fear. You know, the accuser is accusing you of things all the time, but the Bible says that the Holy Spirit convicts us of our righteousness. So he says, that's not who I made you to be. See, the Holy Spirit is always saying, that's not who I made you to be. He's not accusing us of our naughtiness. He's accusing us or convicting us of our righteousness. I made you to be this. I didn't make you to live that way. I made you to live this way. I made you to live holy and righteous. I made you to live a life worthy of the call. See, God doesn't call us out. He's always calling us up. Why? Because we're seated in heavenly places. He's saying, I made you to be seated in heavenly places. I made you with a heavenly perspective. See, it's only the enemy that is the accuser. God is always calling us into our created value, eh? All right, number five. The shoes of the gospel of peace. Verse 15, and having strapped on your feet the gospel of peace in preparation to face the enemy with firm-footed stability and the readiness produced by the good news. Now, I think with this one, often we think, you know, the evangelists really like this one because it's talking about going with the gospel. Going with the gospel. But the Bible, it actually says it's in preparation for the gospel of peace. So it's talking about a preparation of ourselves. Now, I really like this thought. I mean, peace in the Bible is the word shalom. In the Hebrew is shalom. But I wrote a thought down during prayer meeting this morning. And by the way, you should totally come to prayer meeting at 9. It's awesome. I wrote a thought down and I put this down. Peace is violent. Peace is violent. And you might say, Michael, that's an oxymoron. That's ridiculous. Peace can't be violent. But I want to tell you that peace is totally violent against the schemes of the enemy. See, peace encompasses every area of your life. Spiritual, physical, emotional, mental, relational, employment, financial, and health. Every area of your life. See, this is saying be prepared and ready with the gospel of shalom. In other words, be prepared in your journey of wholeness to carry the wholeness and spread the gospel of wholeness. I think one of the best definitions of the word peace or the word shalom is this: to break or destroy the authority that binds us to chaos. To break or destroy the authority that binds us to chaos. See, peace is violent. Peace violently opposes the schemes of the enemy. Because the enemy wants to keep us in chaos. He wants to keep us confused and chasing every little thing and living a life that's chaotic. But peace, shalom, actually breaks that authority over your life. The shalom of God breaks chaos over your life. See, some of us feel like we live a life of constant chaos. Rushing here, rushing there. We've got so much going on. This is going on. Oh, someone in our family has offended me, and now I've got this to deal with. And, you know, all of this stuff going on. Someone in church said something mean to me, or they looked at me the wrong way, and now I'm offended, and I'm bitter. And, you know, and it's chaos. But Paul was saying here, be prepared with the gospel of peace. Let the peace of God bring wholeness into your life. And then take it. Take the gospel of peace to those that need it. I love that. Shalom breaks the authority of chaos over our lives. Right, the shield of faith. Ephesians 6:16. Above all, lift up the protective shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Faith. I think faith is violent too. Like I like the picture of a soldier with his shield, not just like, cowering in the corner with his shield, you know, but like actually running forward and like smashing things out of the way with his shield. Faith is a little bit violent too. But as Bill Johnson says, bold faith stands on the shoulders of quiet trust. See, when that peace is in our lives, that shalom is in our lives, when we can peacefully trust in Him and trust in who God says He is and trust in who God says that we are. See, bold faith stands on top of that. See, faith is a little bit violent when in the midst of the trial we say, I choose to still believe. I still believe that God has good in store for me. See, that's faith. Faith isn't just a moment where we might pray for someone. That is faith, but faith is a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle of trust. It's a lifestyle of knowing God and believing in Him. It's not just a moment in time. And faith is a little bit violent. See, if faith opposes the attacks of the enemy, every flaming arrow of the evil one is extinguished when we choose to believe and trust. It doesn't matter what's coming at you. We know it's not from God. We know it's the enemy trying to get at you. But we put up the shield of faith and say, no, I'm still going to believe. See, the other thing that faith does is that faith, when we carry the shield of faith, it gives us the ability to walk forward even though we are under attack. See, if we don't have the shield of faith, we've got to back off. We've got to find somewhere to hide. But the shield of faith, we put that up and we can still walk forward even though the things are coming against us. That's what the shield of faith does. We put up that shield of faith and say, no, I still believe. I still trust. And it violently opposes the enemy. The helmet of salvation. Who knows that our mind is a battlefield? Our mind is a battlefield. So the enemy wants to bring fear, doubt, hopelessness, frustration, and despair into our mind. The Bible says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. I think this is a big one for a lot of people, eh? The way that we think, what we believe. I think that the way we believe, you know, just like a helmet says who what your allegiance is. You know, for the soldiers, their helmets would say, you know, whose side you're on. So when you pop up over that little mound of dirt and the enemy knows not to shoot themselves, but we put on that helmet of salvation and we say, I'm God's. I'm His. A couple of weeks ago, I talked about, well, was it a couple of weeks ago? Ephesians 4? Yeah, about the fact that we carry the name of Jesus. Live a life worthy of the call. We carry the name of Jesus. And when we put on the helmet of salvation, we are saying, we are His. We are His. But the way we think, I think, determines our allegiance. You know, do we really believe that God is good? Do we really believe that all that He says is true? You know, our mind can so easily rule us. See, this is where the enemy wants to battle us. Put on that helmet of salvation. Say, no, I am God's. I am His. I believe what He says about Himself. I believe what He says about me. In 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 8 it says, but since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. The sword of the Spirit. Ephesians 6:17, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So God's word is our sword. So this is the only weapon of offense in this passage. Everything else is a defensive thing. Although I think you can whip out your shield and smash someone with that. But this is the only weapon of offense, the word of God. We must use it regularly in order to be proficient users of it. We must study it. We must know it. But the word, who knows that the word of God is not just this? The word is not just this book. But who knows that the word is spirit? The word is spirit. You know, I've had many experiences where God has spoken to me from his word and I don't have a Bible with me. Because the word is spirit. And we must be in the spirit to truly be able to consume the word, I believe. When I was younger, the Bible was just like dry bones to me, and I've shared that with you before. It was just like words on paper. This is literally words on paper. That's what it is. But it wasn't until I got filled with the Holy Spirit that actually the Word of God came alive to me. That actually the Spirit of the Word of God started to speak into my spirit. And things started to change in my life. And so I want to encourage you, church, to consume the Word in spirit. It's important to read it. I'm not saying don't read it. The only reason that God can speak to me through his word without the physical Bible is because I know it. See, I grew up in a school when I was younger and in a church when I was younger where we were forced to read the Bible for hours. By the time I was 5, I memorized whole chapters of the Bible. Now, back then, it was totally dead to me. It wasn't until I got filled with the Holy Spirit that all of a sudden God is starting to use what was in my memory to actually speak life into me and speak the word and the spirit of his word into me. So I encourage you, read the word, but don't just read the word, read it in spirit. Say, God, this morning I'm opening your word. God, would you speak to my spirit this morning? I don't just want words on paper or wise words. I want your spirit to come alive in me through your word. Shane. Yeah. Great. Amen. Very good. Right. Is that helpful? God's word is spirit. God's word is spirit. Now this leads me into the last verse, and maybe the worship team can come back here. Verse 18, it says this, "With all prayer and petition, pray with specific requests at all times, on every occasion, and in every season." So in every season, pray. When it's going well, pray. When it's not going so well, pray. But in every season, with every prayer and with all petition, pray at all times, in every season, in the Spirit. And then it says this in the Amplified Version, "And with this in view, stay alert with all perseverance and petition, interceding in prayer for all God's people." See, everything else is just preparation. Now, we put on the armor of God and we put on the helmet of salvation and the breastplate of righteousness. We put a sword of the Spirit in our sheath and with the belt of truth on, and we put on the shoes and the preparation of the gospel of peace, and we've prepared ourselves for war. But you have not stepped on the battlefield until you start to pray in the Spirit. Church, are you hearing me? Until you start to pray in the Spirit, you are just a soldier in the barracks. You're just a soldier in the barracks, hoping that someone else will fight the battle for you. Prayer is our weapon. Prayer is how we advance the kingdom. Prayer is how we take on the enemy. I don't want to be a soldier in the barracks, hoping that someone else will pray for me, hoping that, someone else will stand up for me. I don't want to be all prepared for war and never go. Church, we've got to go to war. This is what Paul was building to. All of this that he has been expounding it right through Ephesians, and he gets to this point and he says, this means war. This means war. See, we have been planted in the middle of a spiritual conflict. And until we start engaging in prayer, we're just soldiers in the comfort of the barracks, expecting others to fight for us. Where are you engaging the enemy? Paul says, pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit. The enemy wants us to engage him in the flesh and in the carnal thinking. A while ago, I preached on the three chairs, and if anyone remembers that message, most of the time, we battle in the second chair, in the carnal and flesh way of thinking. But God is saying, no, I want you to battle in the third chair, in the heavenly places. See, the enemy knows that if he can get us offended, then he pulls us back down to his level. He knows that if he can get us caught in unforgiveness, he pulls us back down to his level and we're engaging on his terms. See, prayer, if it's true that we're seated in heavenly places, which it's true, totally true, prayer is not trying to pull down from heaven. Prayer is pushing down from heaven to earth. So when we have a heavenly perspective, imagine this. So you're going into prayer one day and you're saying, God, I'm going to engage in this battle, and you remember that you're seated in heavenly places. I want you to think about this. How would you pray if God was sitting next to you? If Jesus was sitting right next to you, how would you pray? Knowing that he is the creator of the universe, that all might, all power is with him, all authority is with him, and he's sitting next to you, how would you pray? That's how we should pray. With a heavenly perspective, knowing that the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, is sitting right next to us, going, yes, yes, yes. That's prayer, church. Let's engage the enemy where he has no jurisdiction. Let's engage him where he has no authority. Church, it's about our position. It's about our position. It's not about the battle. It's not about what the enemy might have up his sleeve. It's who knows that he's defeated. He can bring anything against us, but it's worthless. He's a defeated foe. Jacqueline shared earlier around communion, and you know, when Jesus died, he didn't die for us. He died as us. So he took all of our sin upon his shoulders and he died as us. So if he died as us, then we were raised with him into heavenly places. See, Jesus paid the price as you, and then he positioned you to win. He positioned you to win. Won't you stand with me this morning, and I want to pray for us all, but I also have a video I want to show, and I know that time's getting on, but it's a video that for me just, oh, hang on, not yet. Didn't look like it was coming up on the screen anyway for some reason. For me, it's a video that really stirs me up. It's called The Ancient War Cry. And church, I want to encourage you that we are planted in a spiritual conflict. Ellie and I have said many times that we're not here to lead an apathetic church or a passive church. We're here to lead an aggressive church. But just remember that what's violent in the kingdom is peace. We're not talking about being physically aggressive with people. We're talking about being aggressive with the gospel of peace. Aggressive with love. Aggressive with joy. And we're an aggressive church. We're not a passive church. We're not here to sit in the barracks, in the comfort of the barracks, all suited up, but never going to war. We go to war in the spiritual realm, and we declare peace over our city, and we declare peace over our families, and we declare peace over our own lives, over our friends. That is what is aggressive in the kingdom, is the gospel of peace. Are we going to be aggressive? Aggressive. Amen. Let me pray for you, and then we're going to watch this video, and then we'll do our connect cards, and we probably won't sing a song if that's all right. But we will have a time of ministry prayer, so let me pray. God, we just thank you for the way that you have set it all up. God, you have set us all up, the divine setup. And Lord, I just thank you that even this morning there are people that may have come into this place who don't even know you, or maybe they're searching, they're seeking you, and they're not quite sure what they're looking for, but today you've set them up too. Because today they've come and they've heard about your gospel of peace. And Lord, we thank you, God, that you have set it up in such a way that we are positioned to win. Lord, you have set it up in such a way that we are armed with everything we need. You have given us everything we need for a dynamic spiritual life. You've given us the weapons of defense and the weapons of offense, Lord, to take down every scheme of the enemy. Lord, we know that that because of that, there is no need to be fearful of him, that he is a defeated foe, that he has already lost the battle. And today, Lord, we stand up as a church and say we will engage him where he is powerless. We will engage him from our heavenly position, because that's where you've seated us. Lord, we look with the perspective of heaven. God, how do you see this situation? How do you see this circumstance? And we declare that perspective over it, Lord. We thank you, God, for your goodness. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.